The South Asian art form known as Sufi music has a centuries-old tradition built on poetry and mysticism, coupled with specific instruments, meters, and repetition. One Brooklyn-based Pakistani musician is steeped in that history, yet also going her own way, refusing to let others define her work. Special correspondent Tom Casciato has our story as part of the Arts and Culture series, Canvas.
Arooj Aftab recently debuted work from her latest album at a concert at Brooklyn's Pioneer Works. Her compositions are personal, her performance intimate, but it was far from a solo effort.
The way that I like to kind of produce this music is leaving space for the band. We're all involved in telling a story from this moment the song starts until the very end.
Still, the band is executing a vision of which she is in command.
To even actually conceptualize a band like that is a creative work. Especially a singer-composer who doesn't actively play an instrument, there is this sentiment in the industry of like kind of discrediting women for the work that they do. You have to kind of overstate that you're not just a singer, you are also the composer, you're also the producer, you're also the arranger.
She's also unwilling to let others define her. She sings mostly in Urdu, her lyrics drawn from poetry often centuries old. Her music draws from seemingly everywhere. For example, she'll bring non-traditional instruments like synthesizer and lever harp to a traditional South Asian poetic form like the ghazal. She's even given her style its own name, neo-Sufi.
It's not South Asian classical music with like fused with jazz. It's like it's living in its own world of like a marriage of many roots and heritages. So I was kind of like, I need to like name this right now, you know?
Take a hold of it.
Yeah.
Writing of her recent album, Vulture Prince, the music site Pitchfork said she has as much acclaim to the Western traditions of jazz and experimental electronica as to the folk and classical music of her homeland. The album is dedicated to her younger brother, Maher, who passed away in 2018.
When it's a younger sibling, it's almost like you're kind of, if they're young enough, you know, you kind of raised them too. So it's like such a weird sort of loss.
Her loss and her art converge in a composition called Dia Hai, its lyrics derived from a poem by the popular 19th century Indian poet Mirza Ghalib.
And I loved the poem itself, but it took me a really long time to actually like make it mine. When I was workshopping it and trying to figure it out, like I was in Pakistan and I was hanging out with Maher, and so it's the last thing that I really sang to him. And so that kind of felt important to me that I should really just like figure it out and put it in the record.
There was a time as a teenager in Lahore, Pakistan, when it looked like she would never make a record.
Were your parents okay with you wanting to be a musician?
I think they were like, that's not going to work out for you, you know, like that you're not going to make any money. What are you saying? You want to be famous?
Still, she had the self-assurance to take on a poet of more recent vintage, Leonard Cohen, and his celebrated composition, Hallelujah.
I think no one believed in me at the time, and I really wanted I wanted people to believe that I'm good at music. Hallelujah,
hallelujah, hallelujah. She was more than good. Aftab's version of Hallelujah went viral in Pakistan. It also helped fuel an ambition she revealed to her parents.
And I was like, well, there's this college, it's called Berkeley, and I will get a bachelor's degree and I will study audio engineering and jazz. And they were like, oh, okay, so somebody's organized this for us. Fine, you know, let's do it.
Accepted to Boston's prestigious Berklee College of Music, Aftab moved to the States in 2005. She kept at her goal of becoming a professional musician, but got her degree in music production and engineering.
I felt that I needed some sort of like concrete industry skill. I came out of Berklee in like 2008 or 2009, moved to New York, super recession times, all the music studios were kind of closing. People were making all these products that you could record at home. So it was just like, oh, great. No, they don't need audio engineers anymore.
Audio engineering's loss was composing's gain. Where else would we get a song like Last Night, with lyrics adapted from 13th century Sufi mystic and poet Rumi, put to a beat like this one?
Was even brighter than the sun. I really liked the idea of juxtaposing Rumi with a reggae groove, but also kind of jazz, upright bass vibes, and then like adding this sort of Urdu meter in the middle.
There's just a whole world of things you just talked about in half a sentence. Let's just go back for a minute.
I was reading a lot of Rumi, you know, I was also listening to a lot of reggae. In a jam, like, those two things kind of came together.
I'm not sure they've ever come together before. It's not like, you know, those Rumi reggae tunes that everyone does.
Aftab says for her next album, she'd like to explore the writings of a medieval Indian ruler and warrior called Chand Bibi.
She was one of the only and first female feminist warrior politician badass who, like, released an anthology of poems. I like the fact that her work has never been put to song.
And do you relate to feminist badass warriors?
I think so. I think that, you know, we all probably came from her.
Maybe that's where Arooj Aftab came from. Where she's taking her audience is somewhere new. I'm Tom Casciato for the PBS NewsHour in Brooklyn, New York.
Such a wonderful story.